A few weeks ago, Bambu Lab had everyone scratching their heads when they randomly slashed $100 off their best-selling, market-dominating P1P for seemingly no reason. Well, I think I figured out the reason. And while I know that I said literally last week that I wanted to cut down on doing so many product reviews, this thing kinda just showed up. And I mean, don't you wanna know more about it? And so, ladies and gentlemen, meet the Bambu Lab P1S, the printer that literally nobody saw coming. And get ready, because in this video, we're going to take a first look at it, including what it has, what it doesn't, and how it stacks up, not only to the X1 Carbon and P1P that it joins in the Bambu Lab lineup, but also to the Creality K1 that I recently reviewed. Let's get after it. First things first, what is the P1S? Well, if I had to simplify it, I would say that it's Bambu's new mid-range printer, which fits in right between the top-of-the-line X1 Carbon and the P1P. Some of you might remember that for a brief moment, Bambu Lab actually had a mid-market offering, the X1, without the Carbon. But due to low demand, it disappeared pretty quickly after the first production run or so. In many ways, then, this printer is a re-entry for Bambu Lab into that mid-range within their mid-range. Except if you look at the specs, as we're going to in just a second, it actually offers more than the X1 did, and certainly more than the P1P. Whereas the P1P is now selling for only $599 and the X1 Carbon for $1,199, the P1S comes in right between them at, well, I don't know yet, because as of recording this, even Bambu themselves don't yet know the price, which makes it pretty hard to review and compare, but I'm acting on the assumption that it's going to be around $700 to $799, and future Jonathan will put the actual price right here for all of you. And it probably goes without saying, but the P1S, like the P1P, shares the same platform-wide specs as its bigger brother, the X1 Carbon. That means the same industry-shifting performance, the same app and cloud ecosystem, and the same seamless integration with the Bambu Lab automatic material system. So what's the difference then? Now, I went back and forth on how to structure this video to best serve all of you, and I decided that instead of just listing out the specs, the best, most informative thing that I could do for all of you was to compare each of the existing models against this one to point out what you're getting at each decision level and what you're losing. Yes, I'm sure that there will be a comparison table on Bambu Lab's website, but I hope that I can add some informative context for each of these different features as I go, letting you know what it's good for, who needs it and who doesn't, and how it stacks up against the competition, as well as whether or not that feature is worth the extra money. At first glance, when you juxtapose the P1P and the P1S, it might just look like they slapped an enclosure, more on that in a second, onto the P1P and called it a day. After all, you've got the same black facade, the same low-tech LCD screen, and key fob, and no LiDAR on the printhead. In fact, my representative at Bambu Lab let me know that one of the key reasons for releasing this printer ultimately did come down to users wanting an enclosed version of the P1P without needing to spend X1C money or print the enclosure themselves. But believe it or not, I found a lot of surprises inside of this printer that made me understand that this was much more of an upgrade than I'd initially thought. First, I was surprised to find that this model does indeed include the Carbon or HEPA filter inside for VOCs, a feature that wasn't even offered on the X1 back in the day. What's more, it not only has the LED strip and the camera, which were recently added to the P1P, but it even has the auxiliary fan, which is an optional upgrade for its little brother. I guess this makes sense after all, because the printer is fully enclosed and it will likely need that extra cooling for printing PLA and PETG. Finally, I was quite surprised to see a gold PEI textured plate, the same kind that I purchased aftermarket and reviewed in my Bambu Lab knockoffs video as the only option offered. And I know that the P1P comes with a textured black print surface, but here, Bambu chose this common option that's used on Vorons and many other printers. I can only assume that this is because the P1S, unlike the P1P, needs to be able to handle ABS on top of the standard PLA and PETG, and the original bamboo textured plate must not be ideal for that. I've talked about these types of plates before, by the way, so I won't go into too much detail, but I'm a huge fan of them, and they're generally on my go-to list of upgrades that I do on all my printers, including my X1 Carbon. So in a lot of ways, it's actually a lot better than the X1 that Bambu stopped selling, but obviously it's still not going to be quite as high-end as the flagship model, the X1 Carbon. First of all, you're missing out on that beautiful touchscreen, which makes it significantly easier to do things like load and unload, set filaments in the AMS, choose your next print, and so on. If you're the type of person who will always do all of this through the smartphone or desktop apps, that probably won't matter to you, but as someone who installs a touchscreen on just about every single printer I own, I definitely miss the touchscreen experience. And no, I'm not just being spoiled. This thing is just as frustrating to use as others have said, and I have to think that even an old school click wheel LCD like the one on my Prusa would have been more convenient. The next major difference between the P1S and the X1 Carbon is the enclosure. Yes, it is fully enclosed from the factory, and yes, the finish on this looks amazing in this super sexy textured gunmetal. But you might be surprised to know that this isn't aluminum like the X1C. It's actually plastic. Personally, I actually prefer the look of this one, and I don't see any real downsides to having a plastic enclosure instead of an aluminum one. Maybe it traps in the heat better for engineering grade materials like ABS or nylon, but I mean, how much better really? It's not like we're printing peak here, unless of course you are. Look at you, so fancy. The next major difference is going to be the missing LiDAR and printhead camera on the tool head, of course, which takes away the auto flow calibration and first layer inspection features. There's been a lot of discussion about this, good and bad, but the general consensus has been that the P1P and now the P1S do such a good job laying down perfect first layers that you really won't miss the light. I certainly haven't. One thing you might miss though is the build plate detection, which tells you if you're using the right build plate and if it's installed correctly. But since this only comes with one build plate, you also might not. Materials-wise, this printer should be more than capable of printing just about anything that you would regularly throw at it, though you will want to upgrade to a hardened steel nozzle before printing any carbon-reinforced materials, or upgrade to the aftermarket one that I reviewed in my knockoffs video, which recently came out with a second version that I have yet to review and test. Link in the description, though. Also, unlike the X1 Carbon, which comes with the engineering plate, here, you will want to pick that up separately before printing the more exotic materials like polycarbonate or nylon. Speaking of a wide range of materials, I do need to take a moment to thank this video's sponsor, Sunlu. Sunlu makes a plethora of exciting, high-quality filaments from PLA, ABS, and PETG, but more recently, they've released a lot of unique and interesting filaments, such as recycled ones that you can pick up for a staggering $11.99 a kilo, to tough PLA Plus that I've had a great experience with, luminescent PLA, silk PLAs, and many more. Make sure to check out their bundle deals, which bring down the price per kilo to $15.99 or less. Plus, with warehouses in the USA, Europe, and the UK, Sunlu filament is never far away when you run out. Oh, and in case you're wondering, their spools are compatible with the Bambu Lab AMS. Visit the link in the description to support the channel and to get a great deal on some great filament. Thanks again to Sunlu for making this episode possible. Okay, back to the P1S. Before we change gears completely though, I do want to note that there are a bunch of small nitty-gritty details such as the camera resolution, onboard memory versus SD card, and some small upgrades to the connections on the toolhead PCB, and a lot of things like that. But none of them are really going to be a real factor in your purchasing decision. So if you're curious about those, I'll just link below to the Bambu Lab website. Now, as we speak, I'm waiting on a number of next-gen printers from about half of Bambu Lab's competitors, including Creality and a couple that I can't talk about just yet. And while I did just get the Anycubic Cobra Neo and the Chidi X Max 3 today, I don't think that either of those are actually worth comparing to this printer, given the vastly different price ranges in either direction. At this moment then, the only printer that I have on hand that is in this same price range is going to be the Creality K1, which I released a full review about not too long ago. And that's fortunate because I think that this machine is most comparable to the Creality K1. Both printers feature a full, albeit plastic, enclosure. Both have approximately the same print speeds and performance, at least on paper. The Creality even has a touchscreen going for it, and previously had the ability to jailbreak to a full open source Clipper experience, though they've now patched that with the software update, so much for that. But it's in the actual day-to-day usability and user experience where the P1S really pulls ahead from the Creality K1. First, the app, slicer, and printer management software are leagues ahead of Creality's restricted, buggy, and spammy software suite. Second, as I mentioned in my K1 review, most reviewers, myself included, have had problem after problem with the K1 under-extruding, and its first layers are far from perfect. Plus, since recording that video, I've yet to do a single print on the K1 that wasn't interrupted by a thermal runaway error. And there's no camera, and no compatibility with any kind of material switcher. And the overall build quality isn't as good. And the build volume is smaller. And. But hey, the touchscreen is nice. And at $599, the K1 is actually priced the same as the P1P, which isn't enclosed and doesn't have a touchscreen. But that's not the topic of this video. Stay focused, people. By the way, I know it's a little disappointing that that's the only printer I have on hand to compare to this right now, but I would love to know in the comments below. Even though I'm trying to cut down on product reviews, do you guys actually want to see more comparison videos done on the channel? Like I said, I have a lot of new printers either on the way or sitting here on the shelves, and I'm trying to figure out which videos I should do for all of you. Project videos, review videos, or comparison videos with all of those printers. So your feedback is much appreciated. Okay, before we close and you all rush the referral link in the description below because you're so eager to help support the channel, let's summarize by asking, who should buy this printer? Up until now, the Bambu Lab X1 Carbon has been my number one most recommended printer for anyone who isn't limited by their budget and wants a printer that just works. And in case you're wondering, it still is. Additionally, since it came out, the P1P has been my recommendation for beginners who are mostly going to print PLA and PETG, but who are willing to spend money on a quality product that just works. And in case you're wondering there, for beginners who just want to dip their toes into the hobby without spending a lot of money until they're sure that they love it, I actually still highly recommend the Sobel SV06 or SV07. So who then is this printer for? Honestly, I think it's for pretty much everybody, except for folks who are on a tight budget on the one hand or have money to burn on the other hand. Allow me to explain. I've long felt that you should buy just as much or as little printer as your budget allows, similar to how I like to buy the best, most specced out computer I can on my given budget every time I upgrade, so that the purchase will last me a little bit longer and lead me to replace a little bit less often. However, with the addition of the P1S to the Bambu Lab lineup, I think that the X1 Carbon is now becoming much less of an attractive proposition for everyday hobbyists. Honestly, considering the fact that you can pick up some extra build surfaces for 30 bucks a piece, and that most of us who have the LiDAR and printhead camera don't feel that it's all that much better than the first layer calibration on the P1P and P1S, the only real difference I can see are the materials and the touchscreen. Now, don't get me wrong, the touchscreen is so much more pleasant to use than this clunky car stereo display. But is that really worth spending hundreds of dollars more? I'm honestly not sure. Of course, this effectively means that Bambu Lab is actively cannibalizing sales of their own flagship product. But I think that's the point. Better that they undercut themselves and cannibalize their own sales than let some competitor like the K1 Max do it. Overall, this is a really great printer, and it fixes a lot of the shortcomings of the P1P when it comes to the range of materials that you can print. So for anyone looking to buy a Bambu Lab printer, I'd break it down like this. If you're only ever going to print PLA and PETG, or you want to customize your printer by making your own enclosure, save some money because the P1P will actually be better for your needs. Otherwise, spend a little bit more and get the P1S, which comes ready out of the box to print ABS as well. And during checkout, I would pick up an extra engineering build plate and maybe some hardened nozzles, and Bob's your uncle. You can now print basically any material out there, up to nylon, polycarbonate, and carbon fiber reinforced materials for significantly less than the X1 carbon. Hold on then. Does that mean that I no longer recommend that consumers and hobbyists get the X1 carbon? Well, no. But it means that I really only recommend the X1 carbon if you're either dead set on printing lots of exotic materials, or if you're the kind of person who is willing to spend more for luxury, convenience, and being at the state of the art when it comes to your hobbies. And look, that's still a huge market segment. After all, there are plenty of people out there who buy Lamborghinis for their weekend driving, Patek Philippe watches, and Lilit espresso machines for $4,000. Either way you go, I've said it before, and I will say it again, at the risk of sounding like a shill, I genuinely don't think that you can go wrong with any model in the Bambu Lab lineup, and I'm super excited that more people are going to be able to print materials like ABS with this new model. Let me know what all of you think in the comments below. Did I miss something here? Or is this going to be the new X1 carbon killer? Oh, and if you're considering picking up a 3D printer or any kind of filament or anything like that, I would sincerely appreciate it if you did use my links down below. It costs you nothing, but it really does help cover the cost of creating videos like these. Thanks again to Bambu Lab for sending me this extra early review unit. Thanks to my Patreon supporters who get exclusive behind-the-scenes updates on stuff like this before it ever comes out here on the channel. And thanks to all of you for watching, liking, and hopefully subscribing. You guys rock, and I can't tell you how appreciative I am that you guys have helped me turn this into a full-time job. That's all for now, but I'll see all of you on the next layer.